AKS Automatic makes networking so easy, you don't really have to think about it. My name is Paul Yu, and I am a cloud native developer advocate at Microsoft. And in this episode, we will focus on all the networking configurations that AKS Automatic will take care of for you. So let's go. Let's dig into the networking options that AKS Automatic configures and manages for you. If I head over to the Azure portal, I can see here that the network type is set to Azure CNI. Let's click into that. Here, it tells me that the cluster is fully managed by Azure, which is pretty cool, and that the network configuration is set to Azure CNI Overlay. Now, this is great for scaling because it means that only the cluster nodes will need IPs sourced from the Azure Managed Virtual Network. While pod IPs, well, that comes from an overlay network. So we don't need to worry about running out of IPs for our pods. We also see that the network policy plugin is set to Cilium and the Cilium data plane is enabled for us. This is awesome because Cilium will give us enhanced networking, security, and observability capabilities. This is due to the fact that Cilium utilizes eBPF programs that are loaded into the Linux kernel, and that makes routing and network policy enforcement much more performant. Let's take a closer look at this. So note here that the pod CIDR is coming from the 10.244 address space. This is different from the address space that the nodes will utilize. If I head over to the managed resource group for my cluster, I'll see here inside of the managed resource group that there's a virtual network in here. And the address space of this is a little bit different. It's 10.224. So nodes will source their IP from this address space, but the pods all come from that 10.244 address space. Let's take a look at this. So if I do a kget pods and I look in my namespace and I do a o-wide, I can see that each pod, yep, it's utilizing the 244 space. So this is different than the node IP space. And so here I can scale out to a very large number of pods without ever worrying about running out of IPs. The next thing let's visit is the API server endpoint. You see, with AKS Automatic, the API server is actually projected into our virtual network space. Let's go take a look at that. So I'm back over into the managed virtual network. And if I click on subnets, you'll see here that there's actually a subnet carved out just for the API server. And if I click on connected devices, you'll see here that there's an internal load balancer that's attached to the API server subnet here. What this means is that anytime nodes need to communicate with the API server, that all happens inside of the virtual network without any tunneling or anything like that. So it's going to be a lot more performant. Now, let's take a look at how AKS Automatic helps us with our egress traffic. That's traffic from inside the cluster out to the public internet. You see, typically traffic egresses out through an Azure load balancer, and there is a limit on the number of outbound flows when you egress traffic through that. But with Azure NAT Gateway, you're going to be able to scale out and reach up to over 64,000 outbound UDP and TCP traffic flows per IP address on the NAT gateway. There's one public IP attached right now to the NAT gateway, but you can attach up to 16 public IP addresses if needed. So just note this IP here. So we have an outbound address of 52.188.104.249. Let's go see that in action. So if I do a kubectl run and I run a curl pod, let's see what this URL gives me. This should give me the public IP of the NAT gateway. So you can see here that the IP that was returned by that endpoint was 52.188.104.249, which is the same as this. So just keep that in mind when you need to whitelist IPs for your workloads. So that takes care of all pod networking, API server networking, and egress traffic. Let's look at the fun stuff. Let's look at ingress and how AKS Automatic really helps you with that. So if I go back to my cluster and I start to look at workloads, you'll see here that I have a Nginx deployment in the app routing system namespace. What this tells me is that the app routing add-on has been enabled in the AKS cluster. So what I can do from a user perspective is head over to services and ingress and find the actual service that I want to expose to the public. So you can see here that none of these services are actually available for public consumption. What I need to do here is pick one of the services and I can say, create an ingress. So here I could just work through this wizard and I can say something like store, and I can choose my namespace, and then I can choose the proper service. The app routing add-on is actually integrated with both Azure Key Vault and Azure DNS. So I can have my domain configured for me and also enable SSL on that domain too, which is pretty cool. So I'll go ahead and select my Key Vault, and I have a self-signed certificate. So I'll select that. And then when it comes to the domain name that I want to put in front of this website, I have an Azure DNS zone set up, and all I need to do is configure a subdomain name. So I'll just call it store.aksrocks. Hit review and create, and it'll go ahead and make all the necessary configurations for me so that I can easily expose my applications to the public. Now that the ingress has been successfully created, we can actually test this by heading over to the ingress tab and browsing to this particular website. And there we go. The last bit of networking that I wanted to touch on, it's a little bit of a bonus, but I wanted to just show you how easy it is to configure. If I head back over to the AKS portal and I go down to service mesh, you can see that it's not configured by default, but you can easily onboard the Istio service mesh with just a click of a button. So let's go ahead and click configure. Going to ask you what version of Azure Service Mesh or Istio you want to use. And you can choose whether you want an ingress gateway configured, either internal or external. I won't do that right now. And again, it's going to ask you for the observability resources, such as Azure Monitor or Azure Grafana. So I'll just leave those at the default, and we'll just go ahead and onboard that. The deployment is complete. All I have to do from here is label my namespace to enable the Istio sidecar injection. So let's go ahead and do that. We'll click the automatic sidecar injection button, say add, and then we can simply select or check the pet store namespace. So we can see here that it has been enabled. And usually just labeling it is not enough. You'll have to redeploy your pods. So let's go ahead and do that. And once I've done a redeploy of my deployment, I can do a kubectl get pods, pet store, namespace. And you can see for that one storefront pod, I'm now running two containers in there. And this typically means that I'm running my application as a container and the Istio sidecar. So that brings me back to a recap of all the things that we've taken a look at. So we took a look at the CNI option and we saw that we're using Azure CNI overlay with the Cilium data plane. We also took a look at the API server VNet integration and talked a little bit about why that's important. Basically just routing all node traffic to API service traffic within the virtual network. We also took a look at the NAT gateway and how that will enable us to not be throttled on the outbound flows. And then we took a look at the ingress with the app routing add-on. And then as a bonus here, this isn't a feature of AKS Automatic per se, but I think AKS offers you a very easy way to onboard a service mesh into your cluster. And so we took a look at how we can do that all within the Azure portal. As you can see, AKS Automatic makes networking just a little bit easier. In the next video, we'll dive into some of the scaling capabilities of AKS Automatic. So be sure to subscribe to the channel and hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on the next video. See you in the next one. Peace.